come, 184 of them. It's the start of the Boston Marathon, 26 miles and 385 yards. Here he is. Doesn't even look as if he's warmed up yet. And now the finish. Brother Legionnaires from the Melrose Post drape the flags over him. Governor Allen hands him a medal, and he sure earned it.
The idea that Marty is preparing for a race at age 69 that he's going to run when he's 70 is really beyond comprehension. Like, he might be dead by then. Like, if he's preparing for something, that he might not be alive. He's getting old, you know.
Ancient Greece, invaded by Darius of Persia. At Marathon, the small Athenian army drives the Persians into the sea. Pheidippides, a messenger just back from a 100-mile run to Sparta seeking help, races 24 miles through mountains to Athens with the news. In the marketplace, he cries, "Rejoice, we conquer," and falls dead. The first modern Olympics in Athens restages the marathon as an athletic event to honor the old legend. The public acclaims the race, more so because it is a Greek shepherd named Spyridon Lewis who wins the laurel. His triumph sets off a tremendous wave of Greek patriotism. Runners from Boston are with the American team at the Olympics. The next year they adopt the Marathon for Massachusetts on Patriots Day, an April state holiday celebrating the marathon ride of Paul Revere and the battles of Lexington and Concord. John McDermott leads 15 runners through a 24.5-mile course in 2 hours 55 minutes. And over the decades, the Boston Marathon becomes a storied international tradition.
Just to finish is considered a big honor up in New England, and if you make it, you get a bowl of beef stew. Running up in this set is John Kelly, Groton schoolmaster, who holds the record and only American to win in the last 13 years. With 10 miles to go, Kelly and Eino Oksanen of Finland start to duel it up. Kelly finds the Finn too tough. Oksanen draws away to win by 300 yards.
It's for men only, but Catherine Switzer enters as KV Switzer. Race director Jock Semple jumps off the press truck, tries to rip her number and push her aside. Switzer's boyfriend throws a body block and Semple goes flying. Switzer finishes, but women can't officially run until 1972. Tough new qualifying standards weed out everyday runners, but make elite Boston even more attractive as Frank Shorter's gold medal at the Munich Olympics starts the U.S. running boom. Jim Fix writes a bestseller, though his fatal heart attack while running and some scary finishes deter the faint-hearted. Kasindorf, named Newsweek's chief correspondent for the 1984 Olympics, meets track stars Mary Decker and Carl Lewis. He covers their wins in the first World Athletic Championships in Helsinki, Finland. They razz him into resuming running after years off. As he begins, a televised marathon changes his life.
Here comes Dixon. He's very, very close.
They're even. They're basically even now, and Dixon's going to the arms, which he's been conserving.
At 26 miles, I went past him. I ran as fast as I could past him so that it would devastate him, and he wouldn't want to try and catch me.
In the final minute of the race, Smith trying to come back.
The finish line was just up the road. The race wasn't won until I crossed that finish line. I came around the corner, I saw the finish line, I ran, and I ran, and I won.
There it is! Rod Dixon has won the New York City Marathon. Look at him on his knees, his eyes to the heavens. What a great moment.
That December, Kasindorf runs his first race, the Beverly Hills Perrier 10 kilometer. There, the four-time Boston winner Bill Rogers encourages him, and then...
Welcome to the opening ceremonies of the Games of the 23rd Olympiad at Los Angeles.
The Rocket Man.
Celebrating the 23rd Olympiad of the modern era, I declare open the Olympic Games of Los Angeles.
Kasindorf looks on in shock as Mary Decker, tripped by South Africa's Zola Budd, loses her Olympic dream. The first women's Olympic marathon starts at Santa Monica College, Marty watching his friend Eleonora Mendonça of Brazil on the far left. Kasindorf has watched Joan Benoit make the U.S. team at the trials in Tacoma, Washington, only 17 days after knee surgery. Now she runs away from the Olympic field.
Just listen as she comes onto the track. The gold medal, the first ever in the ladies' marathon, to Joan Benoit. And there'll be such a roar go up when this girl crosses the line. The agony and the ecstasy of the women's marathon.
Eleonora Mendonça finishes last, but on a hot day is thrilled to finish at all, a hero in Brazil. Inspired, Kasindorf trains for a marathon. He runs and runs, though he's no Kenyan champion when it comes to natural talent. The sport even gains an equal place with felines as Kasindorf's passion. At age 44, Kasindorf limps to the finish line in New York, then sets out to qualify for Boston by breaching the demanding age standard of 3 hours 10 minutes. Fred Lebo, founder of the New York City Marathon, advises Kasindorf to try the Twin Cities. He falls short there. In Chicago, he hits the wall, missing the Holy Grail again. 11 times in 4 years, Kasindorf tries and fails, his best 8 minutes too slow for Boston. It is a history of futility. But after a 3-hour, 22-minute New Jersey race, Kasindorf learns that Boston had previously lowered his barrier to 3 hours, 25 minutes. Finally, he is in. Racing in from Hopkinton, Kasindorf finds that one Boston experience is not enough. Crowds are huge, and it's mostly downhill to the fun at the 13-mile point, Wellesley College. Those early downhills wreck Kasindorf's legs. He classically hits the wall on Heartbreak Hill, mile 20, and walks the uphills on blistered feet to the finish, where there hasn't been a bowl of beef stew for years. In Portland, Oregon that fall, Kasindorf qualifies again for Boston. Pioneer Catherine Switzer becomes a friend. In Wellington, New Zealand, Kasindorf runs with her and husband Roger Robinson. Kasindorf's next Boston is more cautious, but at least he runs the whole way. Boston's historic 100th running is coming up, and Kasindorf runs strongly in Sacramento to qualify. Officials expand the Boston field to a record 25,000. See if you can spot Marty in the Hopkinton crowd. To augment 3 Boston medals, Kasindorf tries a comeback at 66. His 4-hour, 30-minute San Diego run misses Boston's 65-69 age mark by 15 minutes. He will be 70 by Boston race day in 2010, and he can qualify with 4 hours, 30 minutes in 2009 at 69. He signs again for San Diego. The aging Kasindorf tries the traditional 20-mile training runs, but can no longer handle them. 6 weeks into training, he switches to the program of Michigan coaches Kevin and Keith Hansen. 3 16-mile runs, tops. It is still a grueling 6-day-a-week schedule. Constantly tired, Kasindorf battles additional obstacles of skepticism.
My concerns are that sex is going to be very, very quick, like he's sprinting, like he's trying to get to the finish line. Quickly.
I remember Marty from 1984. He looked great then, but today it's a totally different story. There's no chance he's going to make it, and personally, I think before he goes out and tries to do another marathon, we need to have someone check on the life insurance and also on whether his burial arrangements have been taken care of.
40,000 miles since 1983 take a toll on Kasindorf's knees. Losing 3 days to the rickety joints, he attacks the problem with $4 ace knee braces. The naysayers merely step up their scorn.
And now you're training for Boston. And quite frankly, mate, there's no hope for you. You're going to have a second thought, and you're going to go and stay in the Caribbean for 6 months.
Undissuaded by his lack of natural ability, Kasindorf presses onward because Boston is the Olympics for the everyday runner. Even to keep trying represents a triumph of the human spirit.
Marty becomes obsessed with his marathon training. He marks down how many miles he has on his shoes. He writes down in his journal. And I try to monitor him as carefully as I can, but it's very difficult at times because he becomes secretive. Whatever he talks about is about running. He has piles of running magazines. And whenever he goes for a run, he comes in and tells me about every little thing that happened on the run, the cat he saw, how his shoes are fitting, about how his body's feeling. He becomes all-encompassing.
Thirty-eight seconds into the run, Kasindorf encounters Rick, the Maine coon cat. The run comes to a mandatory halt, then resumes.
Rolling down Imperial Highway, the big nasty at my side, Santa Ana winds blowing hot from the north. We were born to ride. Roll down the window, put down the top, crank up the Beach Boys, baby. Don't let the music stop. We gonna ride it till we just can't ride it no more. From the side.
running at such an advanced age is unbecoming. Really kind of almost senile, because all you have to do is just run one foot in front of the other, one foot in front of the other, and it's just kind of dumb.
On the very spot where the men's and women's Olympic marathons began, Kasindorf sweats through a weekly track workout.
Loss of weight is a turnoff because there isn't a lot of flesh to grab onto. I reach up and he's not there. I've been trying to feed Marty more carbohydrates, more potatoes, more rice, really stacking the plate really high with food that hopefully will help him gain more weight.
I'm very happy to have Martin to run in Boston, but it is too tough. For me, it is very tough.
Everything is ready. The last worry is the weather and the high-tech timing tag on Kasindorf's $150 shoes. If the tag is not placed correctly, he will get no official finishing time. Just before the 6:30 a.m. start, the weather is nearly ideal. 59 degrees, overcast. In a sport dominated by East Africans, Kasindorf's Russian-Jewish background may yet give him an advantage. To dodge the pogroms, his ancestors had to be either very fast or very funny. Funny won't cut it today, so Kasindorf must hope that somebody in the old country has passed on some speed and, even more important, endurance.
Hey guys!
Alright!
Gotcha! Gotcha! Go, Marty! All right, Marty! Yay! All the way! Love you!
His legs turning to lead by mile 11, Kasindorf struggles up a 3-mile hill, gulping Tylenols and hallucinating that he is an Ethiopian.
Haile Gebrselassie writes yet another chapter in the most astonishing distance running career in history. 2 hours, 3 minutes and 57 seconds unofficially there. Haile Gebrselassie.
Probably a back to bar. At 20 miles, I felt I had a shot. I was getting discouraged, but then I did some quick calculations. And I thought if I just hung in there and showed some guts, I could do it. I made Boston with 10 seconds to spare, 4:30, 49. They give you 4:30, 59 for my age group. All the sacrifice, 16 weeks. Training, 616 miles of running to get ready. The pain and agony of the course itself, the hills, the quadriceps pain, it's all worth it. Training paid off, finished in a strong sprint. I passed and beat thousands of people, third my age, half my age. So I'm happy. I'm tired but happy. I think I proved that an old guy could do it after all. And as for Irma, she was actually kidding about all those things she said. Here's what she really thinks.
I see him as being healthy and very fit when he does it, and it makes me feel like I won't be having to take care of him. You know, he's 11 years older than me, and sometimes I worry, but I'm quite sure because he's so physically fit that he will stay healthy for many, many years.